Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 233, recorded Monday, January 11th, 2016. Vincent Laforet. Triangulation is brought to you by DigitalOcean. Simple, fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. You can try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com. And once you sign up, make sure you enter the promo code Triangulation in the billing section. You'll get a $10 credit. And by Wealthfront. Wealthfront is a low-cost automated investment service that is the most sophisticated way for you to invest your money. Whether you got millions or you're just starting out, visit wealthfront.com/triangulation to sign up and get your free personalized investment portfolio. That's wealthfront.com/triangulation. And by audible.com. To download the free audiobook of your choice, go to audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get to talk to some of the most interesting people in technology. We call it a triangle because it's me, them, and you. If you're watching live and in our chat room at irc.twit.tv, your input and your questions are very much a big part of this show. And I know you're going to have things to say for our guest today. Vincent Laforet is a brilliant photographer who has just put out a book that is now sold out. So he's not here to flog his book. It's called Air. And we talked to Vincent briefly on the new screensavers, but I wanted to spend a little more time with him because I'm such a fan. Vincent, welcome to the new screens, to the Triangulation. Welcome to TWiT.
Thanks, Leo.
Nice to see you
back.
First became aware of Vincent Laforet when he was the first, I think, to do, and this was when the Canon 5D first came out, video with the Canon 5D, and it just was mind-boggling. But you're still a photographer primarily, or no?
No, I've gone over to video now. I do about one or two assignments a year in terms of still photography. I think the business unfortunately likes to classify you or pigeonhole you,
right?
And say now you're a video guy. And I'm like, well, I can still shoot stills, and I still love shooting stills. And Air was one such project.
What is it about video versus stills that you like?
Video is just more of a collaborative process. You know, you can't do it by yourself for the most part. It's much more planned, usually a bigger production, and you generally have a lot more control. Whereas for me, still photography is a lot more about letting go, about serendipity, about luck. There's a lot of planning there, of course. Sometimes just as much as there would be in a moving piece. But you can shoot from the hip a little bit more with still photography. You can discover a bit more. You can walk out with your camera and see what you find. You can't do that with a 30 or 60 person crew.
Reverie, which was the video I saw, the 5D Mark II video, was so stunningly beautiful. I'm sure that was a great a job generator for you.
It was definitely a stimulus. I mean, basically that came out and was seen by 10 million people in under a month, which was at the time in 2009 pretty insane. We didn't know YouTube was around and Twitter was around, but it wasn't developed to the point where it is today. So those numbers back then were crazy. In fact, Canon had more traffic on their servers from that one video than they had in the entire year for all of Canon, copiers, etc. So it was kind of breaking records back then. And I'd always, you know, from a young age, I've been surrounded by film and photography. And I chose journalism first, but I always knew I wanted to go back into film at some point, and seemed like the perfect overture to do that.
Yeah, which we should mention that you studied journalism in school and won a Pulitzer Prize with a really talented team from the New York Times for your still photos of the post 9/11 experience.
Yes, that's correct. Then obviously, you know, 9/11 hit New York very hard, and the New York Times was the hometown, and if not national paper at the time. And I was in France when 9/11 happened, so I went straight to Pakistan. And I was with a bunch of journalists and photographers that were kind of on the front line, if you will. And I spent the first 3 months in Pakistan, right in the thick of things. I was there 6 days after 9/11.
Wow. That must have been an interesting experience because we were perceiving them as the enemy, I think, yeah?
It was a completely mind-blowing experience in that I was a sports photographer to that point.
Oh.
I had no conflict experience whatsoever.
Very different experience.
And when bullets fly, I stay on the ground. They don't really care, you know, what kind of person you are, your ideology, or what you stand for. They hate whatever's in their way. And, you know, we had some pretty serious calls several times, some near-death calls during that time. And, you know, guns pointed to the head, you name it, getting surrounded at checkpoints by 40 guys with AK-47s and, you know, threatened. But what we learned is, or what I learned or reconfirmed was that, you know, back then and even today, the extremists are an extremely small minority. And, you know, Muslims and at that point, Pakistanis were 90% plus, 99.99999% plus friendly towards America and towards the rest of the world. And it was just, you know, they were becoming victimized by what was happening over there or during these series of events. And our job was to kind of show that, you know, these are not all terrorists.
Yeah, just remarkable stuff. And we say this is not all, that one's your shot,
yeah.
But there's not all your shots. It's,
An experience right there. That's a gentleman staring into my eyes at a rally where...
And not exactly in a friendly manner.
No, you can definitely read that hatred. And it was here. I was on stage with 10,000 people saying, you know, yelling, kill Americans, kill Bush. And I was the only foreign journalist up on that stage. And, you know, it's a kind of an out-of-body experience.
Wow.
You kind of knew that if you met that guy somewhere else, not that situation, it might not go down as well.
Yeah. Here's another one. Yeah.
This is a barbershop in Quetta. So, you know, life was going on normally there. You know, that most people had nothing to do with this.
How did you get this assignment, given that you were a sports reporter?
I just was at the wrong place at the right time. I couldn't fly back to the States, and Americans couldn't fly out of the States for several days.
So because you're already out of the country, they said,
hey, guess what?
You're going to Pakistan.
You're going to Pakistan. And I was like, okay.
Oh, man. Very dramatic stuff. You're Swiss born.
Yeah.
That's the name, Laforet, the Forest.
That's French, but my mother decided to go skiing when she was...
Oh, really?
Once pregnant, so that's why I was born in Switzerland. But both parents are French. I grew up in France till the age of 5 when I came to New York, knowing one word of English, which is sheriff, which is the same one in French and English.
Sheriff.
That's what a 5-year-old knows.
Does that help? I mean, admittedly, from 5 years old on, you're an American. So, and yet, does it help a little bit to have a more international perspective?
It helps so much because I grew up bilingual. So I would go to France and French wouldn't know I was American, and I would be here and people wouldn't know I was French. And you learn to blend in. You learn to hear things. You observe life in a much more different way because you hear the biases, you hear the jokes, you hear you know, all the bad stuff being said. And you know you learn how to blend in and hide your identity a little bit, or not necessarily hide it, but blending in is the best word I can say, as being perfectly bilingual at the time. And that really prepares you for being a journalist, because journalism is not about taking sides. It's about documenting. It's about listening. It's about, you know, just recording history, often when you're an outsider yourself. And that taught me a lot during my early years on how to be more of a neutral or, you know, more of a listener and an observer. That is able to infiltrate as a, it's got a negative connotation, but to be able to be part of something else and to document it. You know, this scene of the little girl is the image that ended up representing the Pulitzer Prize, and that was a really special moment where you know, it sent chills down my spine. We were surrounded by hundreds of kids at this UN, actually, it wasn't a UN camp, it was a regular camp of displaced people from Afghanistan. And all the kids were jumping around, and suddenly I made eye contact with her. And the whole world stopped for 5 minutes. You know, literally everyone just stopped, like in a movie. And there she was by herself, and we had this exchange and this photograph with the shadows of the people. And these were all refugees coming in from Kandahar, in the middle, in the thick of things. Quite a moment.
Of course, that's the key to... street photography to journalistic photography is the moment, right?
Yeah.
You want to capture a specific moment, a moment that tells a story, but it's a moment in time that jumps out at you. Were you a journalist first, then a sports photographer?
I was a sports photographer first, then a journalist.
Okay.
Yeah, and sports was always intertwined throughout my career, but less and less.
So sports is the same. I mean, you want to capture that dramatic moment. In fact, really, though, a sporting event is all about creating those dramatic moments, and you kind of know where they're going to be and know when they're going to happen, and it's really a question of positioning yourself. And
but you don't know when the, you don't necessarily know. That's the challenge. I mean, you know they're going to be some, but is it going to be the is it going to be the strikeout? Is it going to be the single, the bunt? Is it going to be the error at second base? Is it going to be the outfielder? Is it going to be a fan catching the ball? You know what they could be, but you ultimately don't know. And to your point, though, you only have one chance at it. And there is only one moment. There's no debate on who won the game, who lost the game, game-winning home run. And if you have it or you don't. And that really prepares you for being a photographer that covers news in that you realize the importance of any event and being ready and prepared to capture it.
Must be. Was baseball your favorite?
No, it was my least favorite because
it's all over the place, right?
I covered the Yankees, and they had the longest games, and they would always go into extra innings, and you have to shoot every single pitch because it's the Yankees, and so historical that after years of doing it, I think I've done 7 or so World Series, maybe 9. I don't know how many millions of pitches I've shot, and it gets a bit repetitive. You know, sports like football are significantly more exciting to shoot.
But you do have some classic shots of Derek Jeter and some
and Sam Sosa, McGuire.
Yeah, great Yankee moments that no one will ever forget.
Sure.
But
yeah.
I'm searching for some of your shots. Was it mostly for the Times? Or was it for Sports Illustrated?
If you search for Sosa and Laforet, maybe McGuire, there's some pretty classic moments there.
Sammy Sosa.
But or the Olympics. I mean, I did 4 Olympics.
This is This is presaging your aerial photography.
Exactly. Yeah. This was the article that kind of changed everything. I think that's the article. But anyway,
yeah,
that's Sammy Sosa image. That I was kind of hoping you'd find, which was, to me, the first image I ever made as opposed to taking. And what I mean by that is most of us as photographers are passive. We wait for the moment and we push the button. Whereas the more veteran photographers are actually pre-visualizing and not literally creating the moment all the times. And in terms of news and sports, you can't. But in this case, the angles from first and third base were really just not interesting. So the only angle to get at that stadium was from overhead. And I just love the way the geometry lines up perfectly between his body, the bat, and the foul lines, and, of course, home plate.
So the geometry and then the precise moment. Where were you?
I was up for 11 innings in the catwalk.
Oh, my God.
One of the hottest days in the Houston Astrodome. There was 110 up there. And, of course, it had to be extra innings. And this was shot on film. So for the entire time, I didn't know if I had the moment. We couldn't chimp.
Wow.
You know, where you jump up and down and go,
I got the shot. I got the shot.
I got the shot. No. So you had to – I used the old metronome trick. I was a musician as a kid. So I would time it. And on the second click, I pressed the shutter and hope my timing was on.
So you don't even have, I guess in those days, motor wind at this point. You're just trying to get that.
They had cameras out there that 700 frames a second, and you still have only 1 or 2 frames of the ball in the frame.
Wow.
That swings pretty darn fast. So you got to time it. You get it or you don't. That's the ultimate secret, I think, to not only sports photography, but also to photography in general, is you've got to work yourself to a discipline where you just take one frame and you get it or you don't.
Is it pre-visualization? Is that the key for you?
For this image, yes. And since then, absolutely. I think, you know, early on in my career, I was much more of a reactive photographer. I enjoyed that aspect of it. I still do, not knowing what you're going to get. I love going out with my kids and taking a camera and you know, having little moments happen. But most of the time, you know, I've been doing this for 20-plus years now. I can really see the moments coming. And photography is ultimately about anticipation, knowing people, knowing their habits, studying them, and predicting what's going to happen several seconds in advance. Those are what the best photographers do on a regular basis. They're incredible observers, and they're seldom surprised at what happens, you know, or if they are, they're already framed up and ready you know, for whatever is going to happen, and they get these incredible images.
Are you born with that instinct, or do you learn it?
I don't know. I've always been a big proponent of hard work. I can tell you that when I was, you know, in my late teens and early 20s, I worked around Sports Illustrated photographers all the time. The company you saw there was called All Sport, and it's now part of Getty Images. But those were some of the best sports photographers in the world. I was a young pup, and what I noticed as a clear connection between both the All Sport photographers and the Sports Illustrated photographers was they were the first ones there, the last one out, without exception. Even, you know, John Beaver, who was a famed Sports Illustrated photographer, you know, he could rest on his laurels, but he was there before we were, and he left after we did, and he was in his 60s or maybe late 50s at the time. But the point is, you have talent, you cultivate that talent, but there's just no replacement for hard work. And that works into directing and everything else I've done. I think, you know, we all work an insane amount of time and hours.
Yeah. By the way, this is a great article in Sports Shooter. You can find it on the internet, and that's exactly what you say. He says, you write in the article, when I was 15, I was naive enough to send my work over to ICP to ask Cornell Coppa for his advice on what to do with my career. He sent me a very kind handwritten letter telling me to keep at it. Things would inevitably happen. Fast forward to 19, the age of 19 in high school, 13 consecutive rejections during your internship applications.
Yep.
A half-hearted application to Reuters and the News Pictures Photo Desk in D.C., and that was the click.
Yep, it started everything, and I was also rejected from the New York Times internship and eventually hired as a staff photographer. So, you know, I mean, I think for people listening in, you know, I'm sure you interview people who generally succeed. It's important to know that failure is a big part of success.
Yeah.
And that, you know, we don't talk about it enough, but man, 13 rejections in a row as a freshman, that hurt. And it crushed me. And then on the 14th, I applied, as I said, half-heartedly and for my writing, and I got it. And that kind of skyrocketed my career because, the reason I was getting rejected was not necessarily because my work was necessarily that bad. It had a lot to do with being a freshman and the fact that most papers didn't give internships to freshmen. So it felt unfair, but I finally did get that break, and that gave me a really big break to allow me to work a total of 4 internships in 4 years in college. So Reuters, the LA Times, the Miami Herald, I'm a little sick today, but that's what allowed me to get hired at the New York Times. And I think when I left the New York Times, they told me I'd been the youngest photographer ever hired at 25. Wow. So they don't tell you that when you get hired.
Photography is one of the disciplines still to this day that has a great tradition of assistance, of internships, of learning at the foot of a master.
Yep.
And I think that is one of the things that makes photography still to this day really a great thing for a younger person to say, I want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
There's opportunities. I'm sure you have young assistants even now.
No. Not really.
Screw them. But you have assistants.
I have assistants, but they're usually extremely experienced. It's become so competitive out there.
You can't. At this point, you can't. You can't.
I can't. The jobs I'm doing are too big. I'm working for jobs like Apple and stuff like that. There's no room for error. So we try to limit first-timers, but... I definitely have mentored people throughout my career. I still do to this day. I have several people I'm in touch with on a very regular basis that, you know, call me at midnight or 11 for, you know, advice. And I wouldn't be here were it not for all the photographers and journalists that gave me advice and all the teachers. This is a job you learn on the job. You can't really learn it from a book, in my opinion. You've got to go out there and you've got to have someone rip your stuff apart. My father's a photographer, by the way, and people always assume that he helped me in my career, but he was in France. So the only way he really helped me is in terms of career was in terms of trying to make me a better photographer. First of all, he didn't want me to become a photographer at all. He did everything he could. He sent me to the black and white dark room for an entire summer, the color dark room. Hoping I would hate it. And it didn't work. And then, I would give him my 30 best slides of the month, and he'd stack 10 up over here and 10 up over there, or 20. And he'd open his drawer up and... right through the 20 slides that were out of focus or poorly exposed, and said, I don't care what you want to say or what you're seeing. If it's not exposed properly or in focus, it's not relevant. So it's a bit extreme. So I have a pretty tough skin as a result. I've never really taken criticism poorly, mostly because I've been seeking it out. I was very young on the bell curve in terms of my experience level because of that early start at around 15. But most people kept telling me, hey, you're doing really good for your age. And I kept responding, that doesn't help me get any better.
No.
you've got to tear through my work. And yeah. I think it's the most healthy thing for any artist. It kills you a little bit, but you've got to be willing to take in criticism, analyze who it's coming from, if it's valid. That's always the hard part. Everyone has an opinion. Doesn't mean it's right or good for you, but you should listen, you know, to what they're saying and why, and ask yourself, and it'll help your photography get better. I've always told people, if you're studying your successes, your best images, of your own work, you're not going to get better. You've got to study all the ones that failed and make sure it doesn't happen again, and that's what's going to make you better.
We have more coming up with our guest, Vincent Laforet, but actually I want to talk a little bit about our sponsor today. I'm thrilled to, actually, because I love these guys. This is the first time they've advertised on a Triangulation. Let me log into my DigitalOcean account. What is DigitalOcean? Well, if you see, this for me is a great thing because I often run across internet stuff I want to try, web servers, wikis. I'm learning Clojure. And what I need is a quick, simple hosting service that allows me to tinker, to play. And DigitalOcean is so awesome. You know, it is the fastest growing cloud infrastructure provider because developers love it. In fact, I'm going to show you right now. I've logged into my DigitalOcean account. They say you can create your own, provision your own server in 55 seconds. They call them droplets. These are virtual private servers. They can be customized and deployed easily to host websites, web apps, production applications, personal projects. I use it for personal projects, virtual desktops, almost anything else you can think of with full root access. And look at the OSs. Of course, Ubuntu, that's the easy, but they now have FreeBSD, Fedora, Debian, CoreOS, and CentOS. So let's spin up an Ubuntu, and you have your choice. I always do the $5 a month because it's easy to increase the size. In fact, everything's easy. Choose your server location. I always choose the nearest one. Incidentally, you can also do one-click apps. So you could set up a Docker instance or just a simple LAMP stack if you want, MongoDB. You know, this is great for own cloud. If you want to create your own cloud instance, you need a server to host it. And this, you can do this simply and easily. And man, is the price right on this. As little as $5 a month. For that, you get 512 megs of RAM, a CPU, 20 gigs of SSD, very fast storage, a 1,000 gigabytes transfer. All of that's great. You can easily add your SSH key so it's quick to log in. Let's see. Let's create a host name. Let's just go demo. Now, I just want to show you how fast this is. It's going to take me under a minute in most cases to create and provision my very own server. That's those SSD disks. They're so fast. It's also just as easy to get rid of it. You know, we all use it here. Brother Robert uses it. Randall Schwartz uses it. Aaron Newcomb uses it. As I showed you, pre-configured one clicks that make it very easy. Node.js, you want to start learning Node.js or write your own software. Get your server running. Look at this. Wait a minute, keep showing the screen. Keep showing my screen. It's almost done. Ready? Boom! Bam! I got a server. That's it. It's done. It's ready to go. It's fully provisioned. You've got console access. You can do all sorts of stuff with it. Did you see how easy? In the commercial, I set up and provisioned a server. Want to set up a mail server? You can do that. Django, easy. And what I love about this is the community. The support community is very rich. There are documents on how to set up everything. So you can search for, as I did, Clojure and DigitalOcean. And there's a whole, you know, step-by-step on actually creating your first Clojure demo app. I've already got a bunch of droplets going, and it's easy to do. And it's easy to get rid of them. Should I show you that? Let me show you my droplets. And when you're done using your droplet, my demo droplet that I just created, let's destroy it. It's as easy to destroy as it is to create. Boom. Are you sure? Yeah, get rid of that. DigitalOcean is incredibly affordable and very straightforward in their pricing. It's very easy to use. Servers start as I showed you, $5 a month. In most cases, that's plenty for what I want. There's also hourly pricing, so if you're just going to use it from time to time, you can do that. Starts at less than a penny an hour. Now, we're going to make it free for you to start your first droplet. Visit DigitalOcean.com, create an account, confirm your email, then go to the billing section and use our promo code Triangulation, and you'll get $10 free. That's a month or two of their servers of a droplet. That's plenty to get started and explore what DigitalOcean can do. DigitalOcean.com. Once you sign up, offer code is Triangulation, and you're going to get $10. That's 2 months of their $5 server, and that's plenty for everything I do. That's tons. DigitalOcean.com. Don't forget the promo code Triangulation. You got to be, you know, if you're kind of the kind of person that's a maker, a hacker, you like to play, you like to learn, this is really, I love it. I use it all the time. DigitalOcean, you see, I'm setting up my TiddlyWiki in Node.js. Actually, I think it's a doc. I did it in a Docker. We're talking to Vincent Laforet. His new book is Air, but he's not here to plug it because it's sold out. It's such a good book. It's such an amazing book that it's sold out. Aerial photography of the nation's cities. We'll talk about that in a little bit, but you really got me going here with some of the early days conversation, taking sure. critiques. One thing you do, I know you sell fine art prints on your website. Can I get that Sammy Sosa? Do you sell that one?
You can get it, yeah.
That's one, a shot, man.
It's one I don't. That's one I don't own. So you know, back in the day, that you'd have to get that from Getty Images.
Getty, okay.
Yeah, and then the New York Times, where you'd have to get from New York Times. But ever since I've left, I've held on to my copyright.
Now you own them,
so that you,
smart
you know,
man.
I do own them. Yeah.
Always keep the masters.
Mm-hmm.
This shot of Sammy Sosa was film.
Yeah.
What kind of was it? 35 millimeter.
35 Fuji 800.
Fuji 800. Very fast film, but it had to be because look at this.
Inside the dome. Yeah, there's weird fluorescent tungsten lighting. It was kind of funky stuff.
And in those days, you didn't have Lightroom, I presume, 1998.
No such thing. We had the early, I think it's a PowerBook 5300C, state-of-the-art back then. I think it was $7,000.
So did you use digital to correct this, or did you do it all in the darkroom?
Very little, because the software was so basic. We were scanning film on a film scanner. So we were going in and processing film at the stadium by hand. I had one of these old Senrac dryers that looked like a huge hair dryer.
It's at the stadium.
It's at the stadium. I mean, during the Packer games, I just watched one yesterday. I remembered going to the men's bathroom to process film, you know, while all these guys in hunting suits are going to the bathroom.
Yeah,
to the stall.
And it's 35 degrees wind chill, minus 35 wind chill.
Well, you're either outside freezing to death, or you're inside
burning
the bathroom
it.
Surrounded by people who are doing ungodly things and processing film. It wasn't the most glamorous life, but everyone would have killed to be in my shoes at the
Heck
time.
Yes.
Yeah.
How exciting. So I didn't realize that. Of course, time is of the essence. And now if you watch a sporting event, I'm the kind of guy who's looking at the photographers on the sidelines, not at the event.
Sure.
You see they've got runners, first of all, doing a couple of things. They're holding them so that they don't get hit.
They're holding their. Those are the special people. Those that the SI guys may have, you know, an assistant that's helping them.
And they've got a hold on them. to pull them out of the way.
Things go terribly wrong. And
you know what, Gronkowski running into you.
No, it'd be a very, very final hit. Most of the time you're focused on something else, and
right.
It's not necessarily because you're not. There's a famous photo last year of the Giants making that. The Giants.
Odell Beckham.
Beckham making an incredible catch. And I know the photographer, Andy, in the background is not shooting it.
And everybody mocked him.
That's the one place you never want to be is that guy. And the truth is he actually shot the entire sequence with the same 200 blind, just kind of holding the camera like this. He has a whole sequence of it, which is pretty amazing. But as a sports photographer, you've got to learn how to pick your poison. And sometimes your job is not to get the wide receiver. You stay on the quarterback in case he gets sacked. And it's very easy to have yourself get sacked.
Yeah.
So focused on a 2-degree angle, you know, 40 yards down, that when a wide receiver swings a little bit too far to the left, away you go.
Here's the picture of your friend going, what the what?
his camera is in hand. And he's
shooting.
But the amount of grief he got for that, oh, my God. I mean, to this day, I don't think he's gotten over it. And he's like, I have the pictures. It's just, you know, change the look, Andy.
But you know what? I love this photo. This isn't probably the best photo of the catch. There are lots of them.
I'll bellow the best one from Getty.
Yeah. It's interesting because you see the ref. You see the drama of it. This is a photo that tells a story, and I think that that's – to me, yep. the best photographs get you, draw you in, and your eye roves, and you go, what? Oh, that and that.
Don't be that photographer.
Just don't be him. What a look. Oh, it's so funny. But you see, his finger's on the button. He is shooting.
He is shooting, and that's pretty amazing.
And that's the funny. I read an article by him saying, I got the picture.
The picture, exactly.
I got the picture. In fact, this might be his shot. I think that's the angle he was at.
That's Al's. That's Al Bellows, I'm pretty sure.
Okay. You know all these guys.
Yeah, Al was my mentor. I mean, back at Allsport when I was 22, so...
Here's another one of Andy, just in the background. So I was starting to say these runners are there and they get they're holding you, but they're also there to get the memory card.
They are for still strangely, given that the problem is Wi-Fi has never been good and in these stadiums, so they still run discs. Yeah, for sure.
And they run it back, but before digital.
You only had two or three rolls of film. Four. And the idea was because it was expensive and wire services only give you so much. And here was the big call. Let's say there's an amazing slide at home base, at home plate during the fourth inning. Do you run back? In my case, get back in my car, drive back somewhere else in Chicago to process the film.
No.
And then you miss the perfect game or the grand slam home run an inning later. So that was always the gamble before digital. You always had to make decisions all the time in news and in sports. Are you the first one to make the deadline? And if you are, you make every paper in the country and your bosses love you. Or do you wait and you're either the turkey because nothing happens after that? Or you are the hero because you're the only photographer left that gets, what turns out to be a perfect game or the grand slam or, the career-ending injury, whatever it was that, those were the hard days. So digital really helped make our lives quite a bit easier.
Wow. Do you miss it a little bit, though? That must have been pretty exciting.
I still miss it. There are parts of it I don't miss, of course. I wouldn't give those days away for anything. Those were some pretty amazing formative years.
These Pulitzer Prize-winning shots from Pakistan our film, obviously, too. This is 2001.
No, those were digital.
Oh, this was so early digital.
Exactly. I was the first, one of the first three or four photographers the New York Times to shoot digital.
Jumped on digital that early.
They dragged me kicking and screaming, to be honest. Because the cameras back then were terrible. These were 2 megapixel images you're staring at right there on a camera that had a crop inside of the of the viewfinder. It was very tough to shoot. There was no latitude for exposure or focus or anything. You were on or you were off. It was like shooting slide film, but worse. And this was during the very, very beginning.
Wow. So digital, though, has really made a bunch of us photographers because it is a lot easier, right?
Yep.
Maybe that's kind of the bane of pros like you.
The bane is the word that came to my mind. Right up there when you brought that word
I can
up.
Take pictures. And yet it is an opportunity for somebody who wants to get good. You mentioned take criticism.
Yeah.
Be harsh. If you're taking a lot of shots, you have the opportunity to do that. You don't have to worry about the cost of film.
Correct. I mean, when I was a teenager, I would sit in my closet with cue cards, plus 1/3, plus 0.6, plus 0.9, and learn how flash worked. The hard way and find out, 3 to 4 days later if I had it right. So it was very hard to learn. It took quite a bit. And you didn't have that little screen on the back to have instant confirmation. So it was a much steeper learning curve and much fewer of us could do it. There was no autofocus when I started. That's why I was a sports photographer. It was definitely not by choice. I just happened to be really good at focusing.
Fast, very quick at focusing.
Yeah, and just mentally focused.
You want to have some nightmares? You remember these?
Oh, yes, I do. I remember that fondly. I love that. That was the magic machine.
You'd buy a big spool. This is how you save money. You'd buy a big spool of Tri-X.
Yep.
And then these little cartridges, and you'd roll your own film. And you'd get the cost down to a penny a shot if you do your own developing and printing.
It was wonderful when those cartridges, had the top ring pop off, and you lost your whole film.
At any moment.
Any moment, it could just pop out.
Come right up.
Everything. Yep. That is such a joy.
Oh, whoops.
There you go. Whoops. That's your career.
That was the second base shot. Oh, man. I lost it. Wow, I can't believe you're doing photo processing in the bathroom at Lambeau Field. Oh. That just blows my mind.
And lots of less glamorous places.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know if there's much less glamorous than the men's room at Lambeau Field.
That's pretty low. I got to tell you.
We're talking to Vincent Laforet.
The smells, sounds that are coming out of the bathroom.
Just hold your nose.
Here for days prior to the game.
People complain about this chemical smells when doing your own processing. That's nothing.
Well, that's the good. That's the stuff that smells well.
Right. You kind of get that in your head, don't you? And then you smell it again, and the whole thing comes back. Yep. Vividly. We're going to take a break. Talk about Air. This is Vincent Laforet's newest, beautiful. Oh my gosh, is this a beautiful book? And there's a trick to it, which we won't tell you until we come back. How he got these amazing shots. More with Triangulation in just a bit. But first, let me talk to you a little bit about our sponsor today, Wealthfront. Investing is a challenge, but you got to do it, right? You can't just. First of all, you've got to save. You're saving. I hope you're saving. Please save. You got to save for a rainy day, you know, emergency fund. You got to have an emergency fund. What do they say? Emergency fund should be 3 to 6 months of your income. You're saving for a house. You're saving for retirement. You're saving for your kids' college education. You've got savings. But don't just put in a savings account or a CD. You're going to make so little money on that that you're basically going backwards. What you want to do is invest it. But investing is hard, and I understand that. Now, a lot of people like me, I read all the books, Burton Malkiel's The Random Walk Down Wall Street and Charles Ellis's investment books. And I studied it up with all the best intents, set up an account, invested, and then forgot about it for 10 years. Didn't rebalance it, didn't do anything. And, of course, then you look and you go, oh. But you don't really want to, you know, this is long-term holds. You don't want to mash it all the time. Maybe you went to an investment advisor. Have you seen your bill lately? 1-3% of the money that they're managing every year, not to mention the transaction fees and the hidden charges. That means you've got to make 3% more every year to pay for the investment advisor. That's not a good solution. I got a better one. This is Wealthfront. And frankly, it's the best management you can get because it's computerized. It's automated. And it's automated using those same investment principles of the people whose books I read, like Burton Malkiel and That Random Walk Down Wall Street and Charles D. Ellis. They've got more than 200 years of investment experience on their board, more than 16 investment books by their board members, and good stuff. This is quality stuff. And so they've put that intelligence into the software. And the software does stuff that no human can do. It rebalances constantly. It's always doing tax loss harvesting to make sure that you're maximizing your return while minimizing your tax bill. This is stuff even that 3% investment advisor just can't do for you. Constant management. And you can always see it. It's always transparent. So you have your dashboard, you have the apps, so you can always see what they're doing on your behalf. We hear from so many Twit fans who have used Wealthfront because of us and love what it can do, the diversification you get. They're smart, too. You know, they sell stock in one category, but they keep you in the category by buying another stock in the same category. It's just smart stuff. It lets you participate in the technology revolution that's going on as well. Like $5 a month on a $30,000 account. It's very affordable with no additional charges, no hidden fees. No wonder they've grown over 20 times in the last 2 years. I want you to try it out. The minimum investment is $500. Just if you even just do that, although your first $15,000 will be managed entirely free of charge. So please, set up a savings account for your rainy day fund or for your kids' college education, for that new home, your retirement, or all of them, all of the above. Wealthfront.com/triangulation. You'll get your first $15,000 management fee free forever. This is such a good system. Wealthfront.com/triangulation. Vincent Laforet is our guest. His new book, and by the way, just go to his website, Vincent Laforet. Watch Reverie. Look at his Pulitzer Prize-winning shots. Buy prints for your house. This guy is one of my favorite photographers, and I think it's really interesting that you started in sports and street photography, and then you've moved to this, which is kind of the antithesis. It's landscape photography, isn't it?
Yeah,
opposite.
I mean, if you had talked to me when I was in my 20s, I'd have told you that, you know, you would never catch me dead shooting a landscape.
That's what old men do.
Old men do that, you know. Like, you know, at 10,000 feet in a helicopter, and suddenly became acceptable to me. And that's what Air was. You know, Air was this pretty special project for my career, where I was asked to shoot an article about psychology, or the psychology of coincidence. And I said, well, if I go up really high above New York City, it'd be really nice to capture the streets and have them look like, you know, a computer chip or brain synapses. And took a little bit of convincing, because it had never been done before that we could find in terms of references. And I went up, and next thing you know, I ended up spending a year on this project, traveling the world, photographing 10 cities at night.
It started with this story of Edmund's health.
Yeah.
And as a result, in fact, you know, there's a great article about this in the IBT. Is this the first shot? Was that the one that kind of started it all? The shot of the World Trade, One World Trade Center?
I don't know if it's that one. It was the series, though. Yeah. I mean, yeah. It went crazy. I mean, you know, Reverie was a very viral event. This put it to shame.
Really? Interesting.
40 million people saw these images in the first month. It was crazy. That was what was different, is usually you expect photographers and geeks like us to forward this along, but this was the dentists and the mothers and the grandmothers and the friends that were forwarding these images, real estate agents, and that's when I knew we'd struck something pretty special. I've never had anything like this where it was so universally appealing to people. It hit some sort of visceral nerve. And my plan for last year was not to do a book. I don't think I would have ever – I would have laughed at you if you told me in 2014 I'd do a book ever.
This is your first book?
This is my second book technically, but it's really my first photography book.
Huh.
I did a book called Visual Stories back in the day, but this is my first real photography book. And you know, we spent a year on it, traveling the world. It was an amazing project, and it was kind of the first of its kind, because the cameras – I'd been seeing stuff like this since I was a teenager, you know, flying commercial jets. When you land, you see this incredible landscape.
So gorgeous, and you can't get it out the plane window by any means. Always made me very jealous of pilots, that they got to see this every day at work.
Yeah. They do, and you wonder if they really see it, because most of them are, you know, snoozing or on autopilot. But they've got this incredible view of the world.
Sunset over London, over the Thames. Look at the colors in that.
We got so lucky on that one. So, you know, just to mention for people who are interested in the book, we're doing something pretty cool, which is the publisher and I were obviously aware of the fact that people generally want to buy now. The book's being reprinted right now, the second edition.
Good.
If you do buy a book now, you get a lithograph, which is a high-quality poster that we normally sell for $100 for free.
Oh, that's
so
nice.
You know, we put up 10 lithographs from every city. And if you want to have a print on your wall and frame it, that's kind of the way to go. Go ahead and order a book in the next month and a half, and you will get a free lithograph pretty immediately. And the book, the second edition, when it comes out.
What a great deal. And where do we go to get that? VincentLaforet.com?
Go to Laforet Air. com.
L-A-F-O-R-T-A-I-R. E-T. Did I say I-T? E-T. Laforet. I don't know how to spell forest. F-O-R-E-T.com. There'd be a circumflex in there somewhere.
Exactly.
So these are shot on a Canon. There it is. Laforetair.com. These are shot on a Canon 1DX. I know you're a Canon shooter.
Yep.
Leaf back, though. That's interesting.
We tried to leaf back, and I think there's two or three images that made it in there. The 5DS ended up being the hero. It's back and forth. So certain cities are bright enough, like New York, Times Square. That's the 5DS. The cover is the 5DS as well.
Oh, interesting.
But remember, the 5DS came out in the middle of this project. I was shooting the prototypes and the earliest cameras I can get my hands on, thanks to Canon. You know, parts like that, when you're on a longer lens, that's the 1DX with, I think, a 135 f2.
See, that's what's interesting. You told us this in the new screensavers. You're shooting with telephoto. Most of the time, I would, you know, my just stupid ignorance would say, oh, you must be shooting wide angle. This is 35 millimeter, or maybe a 24.
It's longer. That's a 50 right there over Los Angeles. And it's a variety. It's pretty much every prime lens they make. I mean, I'm going to be honest. We went from an 8 to 15 to a 14 2.8 all the way to 200 f2.
So 200. Wide, wow.
Yeah, it's there's some lenses in there in Las Vegas that like that's an 85 right there.
And you're doing that. You're making the helicopter go higher.
Extremely high, yeah.
And then zooming in a little bit. And why do you do that?
Because it's a perspective we're not used to seeing.
Helicopters
between 500 and 1,500 feet. So when you go up to those altitudes, during the day, it ends up kind of all blending in. But at night, it comes to life in a way that we've seldom seen.
I love this is a little tilt shift here. Exactly. Are you using a tilt shift lens or you do that?
I always lens. I don't believe in doing it in post. I get very angry.
Yeah. You know what? You can tell when it's done in post. It doesn't look right.
You can't. It doesn't look the same. You can't get that bokeh you do in the back there.
Yeah, and look at the bokeh. It's so beautiful.
I was one of the first photographers to actually do it in the air at this point, about 8 or 10 years ago. 2006, 10 years ago. Wow. You know, tilt shift photography, it kind of died down if you look back in 2006 time frame. And myself and about one or two other photographers kind of started doing it again, and I was doing it from the air, and it kind of then it became a picture style on your camera, which was like, okay,
that's not the same. So the idea, and what kind of lens are you using? Is it a Canon?
I believe that's a 24 or 45. Okay. It's always hard to tell,
and it has little screws on it,
right? Yeah, and you rotate the lens.
Move the lens in relationship to the body of the camera. So you, and originally these were used in view cameras so that your buildings and when you shoot architectures from the street don't fall on you.
Exactly. correct for distortion. Yeah, and that's exactly, you can abuse it in this case to get
it's
this
perspective
kind of
correction, but this is not what you're doing here. No.
No, we're giving this diorama look to these images.
So this is, you know, fine focus here. Yeah. And then the out of focus outside. But what happens is it makes everything look like a toy.
Yep. It's got this diorama or miniature doll.
Is that gorgeous. And it was, I think it was gimmicky. It's like HDR. It was gimmicky for a while, and that's what turned people off. But then when you do it right, look at that. That's gorgeous. You just get a really neat effect where you can, and I think one of the things I love about aerial photography, David Pogue said this, and I really like it. He said it with regard to drones photography. Mm-hmm. He said, we're kind of flatlanders. We live in almost a two-day space walking on the earth. So the minute you get up above, it's a 3D perspective of your home that you've never seen, and it's unique, and it's mind-opening. I almost said eye-opening. It was really mind-opening.
Well, it's eye and mind opening in that you're seeing your world that you travel through every day, whether you're walking or driving, and you're seeing it from a perspective you've never seen before. And it's, it's both, it changes your perspective not only literally, but also, what's the other word? This is where you get a cold.
Figuratively?
Figuratively. There you go. And you can see the world in a different way.
Yeah.
And, it's kind of like taking a step back in many ways in life, and you have a broader perspective on things. And when you look down at the city of Chicago like that, you see how we're all much more connected than we think. You know, when you're in your house and you see your neighbors, you think about the neighbors that surround you. But when you see these images, you see there's endless amounts of dreams and people and lives and stories underneath you at all times, and how close we are together. And we're all in this together, if you will.
The other thing you notice immediately when you look at the book, we're talking to Vincent Laforet. He's the author of Air, a brand new photography book, just gorgeous, from PSG. You can pre-order because it's back-ordered now because it's so popular at laforetair.com. The first thing that strikes you is color. Is there post-processing on the color? Are you making it more colorful? Why are these so colorful? I've never seen images this colorful.
You probably have from the street, but not in this context. What's interesting about this is that you're seeing – this is a great example you're on right now. Seeing there is the LED lights, the new LED lights that are very blue in Times Square. And if you look carefully on the left, you'll see the green fluorescence. And on the top right, you'll see the very old sodium vapor lights that we're used to.
Oh, interesting. And so the yellow is the sodium.
Yep.
The green is the fluorescent, and the blues are LEDs.
Yeah, and you're seeing a history of lighting technologies in that one picture. And what's interesting is had we shot this 5 years ago, there were no LEDs, so you wouldn't see this. And in 10 years, if not less,
you won't
the
see
whole
the sodium.
Thing will be homogenized. Yeah. Exactly. And so this is the perfect storm, the right moment in history to capture this.
Oh,
and in terms of like how much work has been done, it's each of these have about 30 seconds of work in Lightroom.
What do you do?
pull the highlights down, and sometimes I push the color temperature a little more towards the blue, so you can see those blues, and favor the yellows, make them a little more white, and a little bit of the vibrance, and that's it.
And you're not; these are not HDR; these are single images.
Single images, so you have to expose it perfectly to get as much of, retain the highlights before they blow out.
How are you doing that in the camera? Are you using a histogram to do that, or are you chimping?
Using histogram, I've been doing this for 20 years, so I know.
You're like a pro?
Right. I can look at anywhere and say it's, 1/30th of a second.
No, really? Wow.
100, yeah.
It's impressive. So,
you do it millions of times. That it's not something you try to study. It just kind of comes with the territory.
On exposing something like this, though, it's not a uniform exposure. Are you using some sort of modified zone system? Or
I could claim to.
No.
You look at the back of the camera, and you're
looks
used
good.
To looking at what that's effectively a negative. And you look at histograms. You have to check sharpness very carefully, because even though we're infinity, we're not. It's so pinpoint. Everything's shot wide open at 1.4 or 1.2 or f/2.
Zoom in when you're chimping? You zoom in on it?
Yeah, we definitely use live view and go 16 times in on the 5DS.
Oh, you're using live view.
Yeah, just to pinpoint the sharpness, because otherwise you'll shoot an entire sequence that's slightly soft.
And so,
it happens to the best of us. And when you're in a vibrating helicopter, it's extremely difficult to judge if you're sharp or not. We made these beautiful gallery prints at the Fahey Klein Gallery that are all 5 feet wide, 15 of them. And the reception was pretty amazing. And a lot of friends came, a lot of, art enthusiasts came, and the reaction was pretty universally, extremely positive, because you don't see this stuff in that way. And with these new bodies, a 50 megapixel body shooting at night and aerial is pretty amazing.
And so you got the challenge because it's not bright, but you want to shoot at a fairly high shutter speed so you can compensate for the.
It's a nightmare. This is we are there's the bleeding edge. We're really bleeding on this one. It's hurting because everything that can tackle you is tackling you. First of all, shooting a cityscape is a lens torture test in terms of quality of lens.
Because you want exact crispness all the way to the edge, right?
And you're shooting wide open. So if there's anything wrong with that lens, you're going to see it glaringly so. And then you've got the helicopter, which is vibrating. It's been described as 100,000 pieces of metal trying to shake themselves loose from one another. And you're doing it at night. You're trying to shoot the slowest shutter speed, the lowest ISO. We're using gyroscopes underneath the cameras.
Oh, interesting.
That really buy us 1 to 2 stops and help stabilize the camera.
That's good.
But, over Berlin, if you look at that image, that was shot at 1/120th of a second on a monopod from underneath the helicopter.
What the what? 1/120th?
Insane.
I can't handhold 1/120th.
Most people cannot. That's 1/120th of a second right there with me praying. If you look carefully, you'll see East and West Germany. Do you see the different colors?
Sodium versus blue. Look at the difference.
To 25 years after the wall's been taken down, you still see the remnants. And that's the whole point of that flight.
What a fascinating shot! So it's the West Germany on the right and East Germany on the left. What an interesting shot!
Yep.
Wow. We're talking to Vincent Laforet. His book Air. You must get this, because it doesn't do justice to see it on a screen. You want to see. In fact, if you can, go to an exhibit and see it in 5 feet. But you want to see it as big as you can, because that's when you really appreciate what a master work. We'll have more in just a bit with Vincent Laforet, but first I want to talk a little bit about my favorite audiobook. Oh, it's so funny. I started listening to audible.com. I know exactly when. Well, first of all, I can go look in my library. The neat thing about audible.com, every book you've ever purchased is in your library. You could download it again. But I also know because the other night, Lisa and I were looking for a movie to watch, and I said, oh, hey, have you ever seen Master and Commander? And she said, no. I said, oh, let's watch. This is one of the great book series, the Aubrey Matcherin, 21 books about a seafaring captain and his best friend, the doctor, on the boat. In the early 1800s, during the Napoleonic Wars, these are wonderful books. And I know exactly when I started with Audible, and I'll tell you why. Because I started listening to those books on cassettes. I would get in a, every month I'd get a box with like 20 cassettes. I mean, a lot of cassettes. And, you know, half the time one was broken and you'd have to stop the book, send the cassette back, and then start again. You only have a month. You have to return it in a month or there's late fees. This was crazy. But I know that I listened to, like, the first, I think, 8 or 9, maybe 10 Aubrey Matcherin books on cassette because my Audible book, the Audible versions of those only begin halfway through. And so I'm going back now and I'm buying them. I just bought Master and Commander one by one. That's what's great about an Audible subscription, by the way. You get a book a month. This is the goal plan. And your first month's free. We're going to set you up. So Master and Commander would be a great choice, but if you like kind of that naval historical novel. But there's so much stuff. Look at this is one I'm very tempted on. The Etymologicon, a circular stroll through the hidden connections of the English language. I love linguistics. So you can really learn, but, you know, you also love fiction. They've got the greatest science fiction. In fact, the Audible Frontiers series has gone back and is recording many times for the first time the great sci-fi novels. Incidentally, if you're a Star Wars fan, you haven't listened to the novelization of The Force Awakens yet. This is, I think, maybe better than the movie. But watch the movie first because there are spoilers in the novel. There's so much great stuff. The Martian? So here's the deal. Go to audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. Your first one's free. Oh, The Fold is so good. So good. I don't know where to start. I'll give you some recommendations, though, because I'm, in fact, all you have to do, I posted my library at leoville.com. I'll have to update it now because I get more books every month. But Master and Commander would be good. I'm just now reading The Life-Changing Magic of Tidying Up. This is that book that's sweeping the world. This was an Andy Anaka recommendation, a biography of Ian Fleming, the man with the golden typewriter. We're learning French. Lisa and I are going to Paris in the fall. So Audible's got French courses. I couldn't decide which, the Collins or the Pimsleur, so I got the first volume of each, and then I'm gonna figure out which one I like and get the rest. My son had to read Joan Didion's Salvador for school. He said, I can't read it. I said, don't worry. Listen to it on audible.com. And it's so much, if you have to study, it's so much easier. Love David. Wait a minute, I got to play. You know David McCullough's voice. He narrated the Civil War. He's one of the great writers.
As strong a photograph as any taken of the brothers together, they sit side by side on the back porch steps of the Wright family home on a small side street on the west end of Dayton, Ohio.
This is his new book about the Wright brothers. He narrates it. As you can see, I'm a rabid Audible fan. I've got more than 500 books over the last, what is it now, 18 years, 17 years? Audible.com. And to look for your book and then to sign up for the gold plan and get your first book free, audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. You know, you remind me, David Bowie just passed away. Let's see what they've got. This is a really neat series. This is the 33 and a third series where they take a single album and they go deep. They deep dive. They really analyze it. Here's Alan Cross. I love Alan Cross. Here's his book, The David Bowie Guide. Here's a number of biographies of David Bowie. Look, this is where I go. When I want to learn, when I want to pass some time, when I'm on the treadmill, when I'm driving, when I'm on an airplane, it's Audible for me, and it should be Audible for you. If you haven't tried it yet, audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. And then I see, every time I go to the Audible webpage, I go, oh, here's a book about meditation called The Buddha Walks Into a Bar. And I go, I got to listen to that. That's what the Audible wish list is for, by the way. My wish list has 56 items. 56 items on it. You can see these are all the Aubrey Maturins that I haven't got yet. The Glyn Johns book about his life as a recording engineer. And, oh, these are all the books I want to listen to that I don't have yet. It goes on and on. Audiblepodcast.com/triangulation. If you don't get started now, it's not my fault. We are talking about the best photography in the world with one of the best photographers in the world, Vincent Laforet. He went from being a street photographer, a sports photographer, to a landscape photographer. But you know what? I'm glad you did, Vincent. Look at that.
Call it an aerial photographer.
Okay. Okay, aerial.
20 years I can be a landscape photographer. The funny part is, I love landscape now. I'm about to turn 41. Yeah, so there you go. It's okay. But I would have made fun of myself when I was in my 20s, 30s. So this is some of the gear that we use, the helicopters we fly in. This is obviously a very expensive hobby. So, you know, when you buy these books, you're actually supporting probably a future book. I think a lot of people have asked, hey, when are you doing the next book? And I'm like, oh, that's a lot of money to put up and find sponsorship for. G-Tech and Canon helped on this, but at least half the project I funded. Not by choice.
Wow, Vincent. Wow.
I mean, but it was so special, and I felt that, you know, it was a project of a lifetime. I think it was. I'm very happy to have done it, and I'd love to do more books. So when people end up buying the book or lithographs, they're supporting, you know, future cities, whether it's Dubai or Paris or Rio or smaller cities. There's so many more to photograph.
You were talking about your dad and his mentorship, and my son, who's 21, is going to Barcelona. He's there right now for college semester, and he was picked as a photo blogger, student photo blogger. So he said, Dad, you know, I lent him one of my Sony A7s and some good lenses, and he wanted some advice. And now I'm not the photographer your dad was, not even close, I'm sure. But there's two things I said. You have two jobs. Of course, there's a shot. There's the composition. There's what you're getting a picture of. But there's a technical side to this, and you've talked a lot about that. Because it's as your dad said, it's meaningless. If you have a great story, if it's out of focus or blurred, you don't have a shot. So you have to do two things at once.
It's the right and left brain, and that's always been the kind of the challenge with this stuff. That's what the iPhones and the new cameras have taken out of the equation a bit, because the sensors, the technology has gotten so good that it's kind of leveled out the playing field for good and for bad, depending on what side of the equation you're on. But the reality is, you know, when I was studying and learning to do this myself, we shot a roll of film. We had to wait several hours to days, depending on if you're processing it yourself or sending it out, to know if your image was even focused properly, let alone exposed properly, let alone any good. Things went so fast. I remember as a student feeling like things were going so fast in my camera. I had no idea if I'd captured it. Right. Whereas now, you know, with your iPhone, you can take an image that would absolutely destroy the quality of the camera I was using in 2000, the D2000.
Right.
So, you know, it's becoming less about the technical. But that being said, if you really study any art, you can't find a musician who can improvise that hasn't learned their scales.
Right.
You can't be at the Olympics and figure skating before you start to, you know, break and skate in a straight line.
Right. Right.
And I think it's very important to study the basics, master them, and then break all the rules. And that's when you do your best work.
That's exactly right. Every art is both technique, mastering the technique, and then creating the art. What images? These images are so so phenomenal, and I'm glad we kind of could talk a little bit about the technical involved, because these are technically extremely challenging.
They're some of the most challenging I've ever done, and they literally push the lenses, the exposure, the ISO, the helicopter, me, right to the point of, you know, having an image that won't work. But that's the challenge. I mean, going out on a bright sunny day at high noon doesn't take much skill.
Right.
And these days, that's the kind of the whole point too, to get to a conclusion about this, is that, you know, everyone can take a picture with an iPhone today that's actually quite good. The challenge is finding images that have not been made before.
Right.
And the cool thing about that initial New York assignment is that no one had ever done this before.
Right.
And it's was a first of its kind, and in 2015, it's pretty rare.
So is that what you're looking for now is... that's really an interesting statement, that because the technology has gotten so good, anybody could take a good shot. So now it pushes you as a pro to go way beyond to find that unique image.
It's happening all around the world, and you don't have to be a pro. I mean, you see all these kids hanging off of buildings,
right.
You know, taking selfies, which I
don't do that.
I don't really understand.
Stop on this picture. This picture is, I mean... Okay, so it's technically very challenging, but also the composition is incredible, and it just...
I didn't chop the top of the buildings, though.
Oh, you see? even Vincent. Yeah,
it's
but
there.
If I don't...
It's on the crop.
If I'd only...
Someone made a mistake somewhere, on my website or something. But anyways.
So it's there. It's just a bad
there.
Crop.
It's okay. Never do that. Yeah. That just.
We're looking at the video. No wonder. I get it. I know. I see how that happened.
Darn editors.
Those editors. They don't, you know.
Yeah.
Man, Vincent, you just blow me away every time I see your work, starting with Reverie and now this. What? So you think, you said you're going to do another one. Will it be another Air 2?
If people continue buying the book and buy into the next Christmas season, which should probably happen, there's a fairly good chance that I may try to do another one. You've got to understand, this helicopter is $2,000 an hour.
Yikes.
That's like pulling out $40 out of your pocket every minute.
Yeah.
When you calculate, you know, the crew and stuff like that. So it's not for the faint of heart.
Yeah.
And you can go. We went to Paris, for example. We spent a lot of money getting there. We had permission, and then we got denied last second.
There's no Paris pictures.
No, and that's
because it's got the Eiffel Tower, and that's copyrighted.
Well, don't get me started on that. But, this is the year with Charlie Hebdo with the attacks.
Sense.
So there was a lot of sensitivity, and we ended up wasting a lot of money and, more importantly, didn't get any images. It was tough for me because I'm from Paris, and it's a city of light. So including it in this book would have meant a lot to me.
Next book. I hope
that wiser minds will prevail and that we'll be able to do it in the future.
So you have to get permission for each of these cities?
In the case of Berlin, for example, we had to get the Berlin Senate to write us a letter of approval based on the previous work. So every city is different, and some are extremely difficult to get permission.
10 cities: New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Berlin, London, Miami, San Francisco, Barcelona, and Sydney, as you have never seen them. Just stunning. And I do hope there's a sequel to this. But at the same time, I'm sure... Oh, look at that. I love that London Bridge, that tilt shift of the London Bridge. That's incredible. I'm sure you have other stuff. You're doing commercials?
That's what I do mostly. You know, I work as a director. I just did one last week. Got very, very wet as El Nino hit the coast of Los Angeles.
But I bet, you know, that makes for good, interesting stuff, though, right?
Oh, yeah. We were playing with some great toys. We had a Russian armed vehicle, which is which is a Mercedes with an arm mounted to its roof. It's worth $1.5 million.
Wow.
And we're driving it 40, 50 miles an hour in canyon roads with triathletes on bicycles. If you don't have fun doing that, you've got a problem with
it. Yikes. What would you like to do that you haven't done? You want to do more journalistic photography?
No, I think that period of my life is probably done, although I have recently started working for CNN doing some Phantom, the slow motion camera
stuff.
As well as some still photography. But no, not the drone, the high-speed Phantom film. So shooting Donald Trump at a few hundred frames a second and some other idea.
Interesting.
Mostly commercials, and down the line, I would love to do a feature film.
I think you will, and I can't wait to see it. Vincent, thank you so much for spending some time with us. I hope you feel better.
Thank you very much.
It's for your art, man.
Thanks for your support throughout. And
Always a fan.
I told the people if they want to buy the book now, they'll get a litho, so it's well worth the effort and the wait.
Laforet Air, LAFORETAIR.com, and pre-order now. Get the lithograph. You get the book in March, and you will be very, very glad that you did. I'm so glad. This is a cherished possession, not just for the photographs, but for the inscription. Thank you, Vincent. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Great to see you again.
Same here. Thank you.
Take care. Feel better.
I will. Thank you.
Really, you know, nice of him to do that because he's a little under the weather, but I so appreciate it. And I get such inspiration from people like Vincent. Thank you for being here. We do Triangulation every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1900 UTC. Your input, we got a lot of great input. The chat room is loving it. It's always appreciated. That's where I get a lot of my inspiration. But if you can't watch live, it's okay because we make on-demand audio and video. This one you want in video. Available after the fact at twit.tv/TRI for Triangulation. You can also find it on youtube.com/triangulation. You can find it on iTunes. You can subscribe. In fact, I would if I were you, because that way you won't miss an episode. And each one of these is fantastic. I think next week we're going to talk to Bill Fernandez, one of Apple's first employees, junior high school buddy of Steve Jobs, about the early days of Macintosh and of course, the Apple II. So that's next week on Triangulation. Thanks for being here. We'll see you next time on Triangulation. Bye-bye.